Kolar Gold has told investors the company is changing its name and ticker to reflect a change of emphasis on the back of a boardroom reshuffle last year. With me now in the studio to explain all is Chief Executive Cameron Parry. Cameron, good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Andrew.
First off, Cameron, let's talk about this name change. Lionsgold, where did that come from?
Well, we're using the emblem of the lion in the name because in India and England, it is, or the UK, it is used as a national emblem. So we saw the connection with that. We also, more generally, you know, the lion is sort of attributed with strength, leadership, and as well as a sense of community. And that sort of they are characteristics that we reflect in all our ambitions and what we're trying to do in our various projects in the various jurisdictions. And we got the ticker lion, so we couldn't resist that. I mean, that's quite easy to remember. We've got an EGM at the end of the month, or on the 23rd, 24th of this month, to get shareholder approval to change it to that. And I probably should explain, we moved away from Kolar Gold because Kolar is a location in India. It's quite specific to the Kolar Gold mine, which historically is a world-class gold mine, and they produced 25 million ounces there during the course of 100 years. It closed in 2002. The original focus of Kolar Gold when it came to market was to see if they could commercially exploit helping bring that potentially back into production. And at the same time, they had also secured an equity position in what is India's leading gold exploration and mine development company called Geomysore India Services. And when we arrived on the scene at the end of July 2016, so 6 months ago, it became, I guess, apparent to us that that's really where the focus needs to lie to generate value for the shareholders and the company, that it's not really for a London-listed small company to somehow resolve some of the issues that are going on between the state and the federal government, the ex-workers' unions and all these type of things that are going on in India around the Kolar Gold mine. In saying that, though, through Geomysore, we also have prospecting licenses and application for North, South and East Kolar. And it's around 70-odd square kilometres that surround the 22 square kilometre Kolar Gold mine, and it covers a lot of those extensions. So when that does, you know, if it does, but it should do, eventually get brought back into production, we are strategically in the box seat to be discussing, you know, whoever's doing that. So I'm sure we'll be a part of it in some way or assist that in some way, but we won't be the driving force of it. I think that's unrealistic for our company here.
Well, back in January, in your operational update, you talked about the company's new three-pronged strategy, attack, if you like, going forward. First off, progressing your Indian gold mining and exploration projects.
Yep.
Just run us through where you're at with those at the moment.
Right. So our gold exploration and mine development interests are held through our shareholding in Geomysore, which we have 20.5% of. They have about three dozen prospecting licenses and applications, a couple of prospecting licenses at the moment, and one mining lease. And so they've got approval for a 30-year mine at Jonagiri, which is in central India. They're going through an economic feasibility study at the moment on that. Drilling is just completed on about another 7,000 square metres. That was part of the EFS and the pit optimisation and all this type of thing. They've already drilled about 16 or 17,000 square metres on that block prior to doing the EFS. So that will take us to a decision to mine stage, and that report will be ready in April. We will have a resource upgrade. So at the moment, we've got 351,000 ounces of gold, JORC compliant ounces there at Jonagiri, indicated and inferred. About 260,000 of that is open pittable. So that has a lesser expense to mine it. So we'll have a resource upgrade on those figures by the end of, end of February. And then during April, around mid-April, we expect to have the results of the economic feasibility study. And as I say, that'll be the decision to mine. So if we're looking at various ways, subject to the result of the EFS, but we're looking at various ways how we may finance that or assist Geomysore in financing that. And there are several ways to do that. And if we do that, we can bring that mine into production by the end of 2018, and that will be India's first privately held gold mine, which is historically relevant. It's it gives tremendous credibility to an exploration company that's been going for 22 years in India. It is India's leading exploration company as far as their portfolio goes. It's second to none. This is a massive, massive opportunity for us. And being in India, and I know you haven't asked about it yet, but we also have a fintech application for the India market. You know, you're dealing with a market there that is vast, that anything you produce from the mining industry is just going to get absorbed by that market, without even, without batting an eyelid. India as a country is the second largest consumer of gold in the world. They consume about 700 tons of gold a year. They only produce 2 to 3 tons. So if we're producing some tonnage of gold, obviously it's just going into that local market.
So a vast market, you say. What's the operating environment like over there?
It is traditionally kind of bureaucratic and can be slow going. So you kind of need to, somebody needs to spend the time there. And this is where our partnership with Geomysore is so valuable to us, because Lionsgold's not going there, fresh out of the box, trying to establish itself in India. It's not the case. We've got partners there that have been there for 2 decades building up this portfolio, which has licenses at various stages, as I say, including a mining lease now. Somebody's got to do that. So we, from our position from here, we're tapping into that without actually having to spend that time ourselves. But that is why our partners there are so, local partners in jurisdictions, wherever you are so very important.
Talk to me about what's happening in Finland. I know that you've been keen to tap into a second jurisdiction.
Yeah, it was part of our plan to have effectively 3 pillars to Kolar Gold at the moment, to be called Lionsgold shortly. Jurisdictional diversification was important. We wanted something, and through my time as CEO at Metal Tiger and bringing that to market in 2014, I had a relationship with had a good working relationship with the guys who own the projects in Finland. So we were able to negotiate a joint venture on a high grade gold deposit that is near term cash flow generative. We've got an area of about 24 square kilometers there, with 5 prospecting licenses, a couple more on application, but we also have a test mining license, or a license to do test mining, which is effectively bulk sampling. So we can take 10,000 tons of ore there, process it and refine it. And because it is a high-grade deposit, we are expecting, or we're targeting, to produce 100 kilos of gold later this year from those activities that we're doing in that joint venture. So around $4 million worth of gold we're looking to produce this year. And the great thing about that is that when you're supporting the cost of exploration, as we're doing in our structured deal, once you've produced that, then that private company sits there in Finland, which we've established, it's called Kalevala Gold, sits there in Finland, and it's fully funded for the next, really for as long as it wants, but certainly for the next couple of years of exploration, drilling, possible acquisitions in different parts of the country. As a private company in this climate, to have that much money in the bank, it's quite a rare thing.
The third arm to this, fintech gold, yep. Many might see this as a little bit left field, but it's no stranger for you. Tell me a bit more about your background and how this fits into Lionsgold.
Well, I suppose my two most recent public companies I was involved in was one bringing Metal Tiger to market and creating that and bringing it to market in June 2014, and I was the inaugural CEO of that company for the first 20 months. I raised money in that at half a penny. That went through 6 pence within 2 years. It's sitting around 2p at the moment, but still, nevertheless, it's been a great ride and great result, and I'm sure it's got a long way to go with the assets that we and the deals that we did in that company that's now being run by a different CEO, and he's doing a tremendous job. The other thing I did in 2015 was actually I was a co-founder and as executive chairman brought to market the world's first IPO of a blockchain fintech company onto a recognised stock exchange. So that was onto the ISDX, which is now the NEX market here in London. So I'm sort of in a rare position of being having a lot of exposure to fintech and technologies, this type of thing, as well as having this background with a public listed mining companies as well. So I thought we might as well use both of those things. That's kind of a unique sort of selling point or strength that we might be able to tap into. And the the focus with the trading platform is gold. So it really allows people, it's already a tried and tested technology. It already exists. We did a joint venture for the India market, which we're now adapting the current platform specific for that market that we have a 50-50 joint venture on. We got it at a very, to us, what was a low cost. It was an opportunistic a transaction where we were able to actually buy 27% of the technology company itself. So we did that at the same time at the end of last year. And really that allows people to have an online platform like online banking, but where you're actually putting your cash into gold. So it's a direct ownership, physical gold. It's not an ETF or anything like this. You effectively have a 100% gold-backed bank account. And in this day and age, or in this climate, there seems to be a much more growing appetite for that type of thing, where people have their cash or cash equivalents, you know, their liquid assets, for their family. If it's just sitting in cash, a lot of them want to actually have that sitting against something that's tangible, something that doesn't decrease in value the way fiat currencies do over time. And something that, again, of course, that is very liquid, that they can bring it in and out of cash should they need to, and that's what that platform provides. Gold trading is the third most liquid market in the world, behind US debt and Japanese debt. So, you know, you can get it in and out of gold in an instant. Mm. But whilst you're holding your family's asset, it is 100% gold backed, and that's a great thing. We think that's only a growth market for us. We're really excited to bring that to India, because or to focus that on India. You know, they've got over 1.2 billion people. The culture in India, they really understand that gold is real money, that it is a store of value, that it is can be used as a medium of exchange, and it is giving the convenience of online banking, if you like, to actually utilizing gold in that way.
And when's the site going live?
We're looking to release that to market by the end of this quarter, so in late March, late next month.
You touched on it before, but by the sounds of it, there's plenty happening here for you. Have you got enough cash in the bank to cover your activities?
Our current activities, we do. We've got a payment to on the Finland Gold project this month for €350,000, which takes us to 28.3% ownership of Kalevala Gold, which is the operating subsidiary we've created. Our pathway to go to 50% under the current deal structure would require another €1 million. We're looking at various ways we might be able to achieve the same result without actually outlaying that quantum of cash. With the India-focused fintech gold holding and gold trading exchange, I was just about to give away the name of that, so I'm glad I caught myself there. With that brand that we'll be releasing, we have a commitment up to the first 50,000. We've spent part of that already, but if we want to get behind that with a larger, you know, more focused marketing push, then we would need in some way to be accessing new resources or more cash resources to do that. But you can do that through strategic partnerships. I mean, it's not all about raising capital, for example, but of course that's mm-hmm. the obvious one that people are sort of asking about. As far as where we currently are, we're fine and funded right through into next year. I mean, this is how we budgeted our the cash that we brought in when we brought in 900,000 when I joined the board in July last year. But I suppose I'm probably not one to stand still. I don't think, you know, with what we've set up already, actually the opportunities are still in front of us, and the window of opportunity is this year. And I think that goes for India, for what we're doing in Finland, and even with the financial, with the gold trading platform. I think people will be very receptive to that now. And if we can increase what we're doing, and we have announced a market, we're in exploratory discussions with shareholders at Geomysore to see how we as the public company could perhaps own a larger part of that and have more influence over it, which is kind of right for a public company to aspire to do. It will be a moving feast. Hopefully, it'll be a moving feast. If we rest on our laurels, then we're fine.
A moving feast looks like it's shaping up to be an exciting year. Cameron, I wish you all the best. Thanks very much indeed.
Thank you very much, Andrew.